the Catspaw and the image that we were, or the brief that I was giving on season one, which would have been actually the pilot that we never shot. We shot it, but never seen it. We just moved into season one, was that it was in the world of Targaryen. So Viserys, who we had, and Dany, excuse me. And Dany were the only two people in the world of the Targaryens that we're seeing. So the dagger itself had to be in the world of his opulence. A bit unusual and very much more opulence to it. So again, as I was saying earlier, I've always known this as the Assassin's Dagger. And then Catspaw, the name came to it at a later date for me personally. But the make of this, like saying the importance in the prequel, obviously we'll learn in time to come, but it was, for me, it was great to see it in the prequel, you know, and that it actually keeps its true time on. And we see why it comes into Game of Thrones as well, because, you know, there's obviously great importance to this Catspaw dagger itself. It actually looks so out of place because, you know yourself, we're dealing with Winterfell for what it is, a grubby old place, dirty and dingy and cold. And then this nice opulent dagger came out of nowhere going, it's a bit different. So that was the idea of having something that was very much more strikeable, yeah, you know, for how it looks. It was a bit tricky because we had a time frame to it. So I remembered I had this at home in the apartment, and I'd finished the blade. We'd finished all the, because we couldn't use the bone fully because it was a bit dangerous, and obviously the bodkin. So the hero one would have been, you know, quite authentic for what it was. And then we had to model make everything else off that. So a lot of this was all model made and sculpted to a certain degree, to create another pattern and create a shape, you know, that was a bit more usable. So also you'll see that the gold, there's much more gold on this here, you'll see for what it is, but you've got jewels on the front and the side and also on the underneath. So they had to be all recessed. So it's about 2-3 o'clock in the morning. We were shooting on this the following day. So up to about 3 o'clock in the morning when I was still putting the jewels in on all of this, and also the gold leaf, because this is all gold leaf, it's a pattern gold leaf on the sides as well. So I finished that, like I say, about 3 o'clock in the morning, wrapped it up, went to bed, and we were shooting on this at 8 o'clock. So it was quite tight because we wanted a bit more opulence. We had a sort of, at one stage we had it all black and going, that's not going to shine, I'm not happy with that. So I put the gold leaf on it and I kicked it up straight away. So we went, grand, perfect. So like I say, we got it done late in the day, but it was perfect. I had not heard of Game of Thrones prior to it. Now I've worked on a lot of movies. I'm a long time in the industry, nearly 30 years now. And I hadn't really, it was a book that I hadn't picked up. It was not part of my sort of literature that was more just research, a lot of history and that kind of scenario, and fiction wasn't my genre to a certain degree. But obviously when I heard the word of Game of Thrones coming to Belfast, Northern Ireland, and the possibility that was going to be made, obviously I got the first few books of George R.R. Martin's and read the first few. I found them a very hard read because they're quite an in-depth book. Great knowledge in it, and it gives you great knowledge of all the families and the houses, but a lot of knowledge that wasn't prevalent to the Game of Thrones first season to a certain degree. So you had a lot more knowledge than you knew. But regarding the input of this, I had no information of this whatsoever, only that the information that I was given was that the opulence had to be there. It was of possibly Targaryen feel, that kind of feel that it would be of that kind of opulence. Now, that didn't say that it was Targaryen, it just of that opulence that it needed to be in look-wise. So basically I sat down with Will Simpson, who is obviously a fantastic artist in his own right, on the pilot. And we came up with a lot of different options and different scenarios and feels to it. And this was a bone that I had in the workshop. So I had this bone, I did a job in South Africa, and I had I always collect a lot of stuff that I can find. If I can find items that will do me in the future, or visually will help me in the future to create items. I'll always collect them or take photographs. So this was actually an impala. So it's an impala deer. So it's a deer bone for what it is. And the fact that the shape of the impala, the bone itself, is quite unusual. It's exactly that, but then it tends to carve out a bit. So I had to cut the tail end of it off. And the tip on this end of it actually is a bodkin arrow. So a bodkin arrow is exactly to a point for what it is. So I glued the bodkin arrow onto the foremost tip of the antler and created that feel. And then I just created the lines that would just be symmetrical to it. And obviously we created the pattern weld, and which is the Damascus feel to it, which is obviously I can't hear the name in at the moment. Excuse me a second. Valerian, sorry. So, which is the Valerian steel in the history of Game of Thrones. So this is part of the original Valerian steel that we would have seen with a few other items as well. The Valerian steel is obviously, it's a feel that we know it, you know, in this period, you know, the 20th century type of thing. We're looking at 26th century. We're talking about this being a Damascus blade or a pattern welded blade. So it's basically, it's a blade that is added different metal compounds and compositions that you fold and stretch, you know, in a forge. So you create the patterns, you create styles to it. This particular pattern, again, is like probably about 15 to 20 folds of metal-wise, and then stretched out. So the layers and layers and layers are basically creating all the different undulations and the different visual effects to it. We would then create the shape. So the shape, again, is ground out, cut and ground out to make it within that shape. We then would use an acid to take out the, like a ferrichloride, to take out the pattern and increase the pattern. So basically the ferrichloride would melt away on the softer material, the non-carbon material, like the mild steel, and it would eat that away, allowing for the heavier carbon content to rise up. So you get the undulations and the feel and the pattern to it with your finger once you touch it. So that's basically how we came up with it, with the patterns. It's an old, you know, forged feel, and it's been centuries old, the style of a Valerian dagger or Valerian blades. The other fictional materials would be the White Walkers. If we look at the White Walkers and their feel and their, when they first came into, I think it was either season one or two, season one, but anyway, when the White Walkers came in, we had to make something that was very unusual and very sort of unique to their feel, because it was an ice world. Everything to do with ice, their look, their style, was all that bluey feel to them, but they lived in the ice part of the of Winterfell and the north, up by the wall, so beyond the wall. Basically, a lot of that imaging came from research. I was doing a job in Iceland at the time, or previous to this, and I take a lot of pictures and a lot of graphic pictures, and same whether it's volcanoes or rocks or rock formation, but also stalagmites, stalactites. And it was funny because by the hotel we had, there was an area where we couldn't shoot one day up around on the set. It was just too bad, the weather was terrible. So we shot around the corner of the hotel, and within that area was a backdrop of a whole massive big, basically a rock formation, quite a big mountain range. And on that were all overhanging branches, but on the branches were all these stalactites. They were fantastic, and the shapes were unbelievable. So I took a lot of photographs of those shapes, and those shapes are virtually exactly what the White Walker sword is those. It's just the hanging ice and the drips and the shapes and the undulations. And basically what that was a lot of ice sculpture that we had, and overlayered sort of shards and shards and shards overlayered to create that. And we had to come up with a new material. That material is very new to the industry. It was like a white or a clear resin. But we had to make a special oven because we had to bake that. It was like something from Delia Smith's. But anyway, so we had to bake that at about 120 degrees for virtually 24 hours. It was quite a fixture, and we didn't know what was going to work until, you know, the time was up. And as Gren, it was great. It was fantastic. Came out well, but it was very fragile. So we had to make sure that the White Walkers did what they did, but never dropped them and never clashed with them, because the material was fragile. Until the following season, when we got this new material that was translucent in a rubber version, so we were able to make it much safer and much quicker. We were dealing with a show that everybody was sort of enthusiastic about to a certain degree. Now it was new. At the end of the day, I'm thinking about the pilot and the first season, because it was new. It's not going to be aired. We're just making the items, and we're making everything else, and we're trying to create a new world. And they were very happy. And the problem is that every other department were in the same area. So every other department had their own worries, their own troubles, and their own beginning regarding. So everybody had enough to do without me looking over somebody else's shoulder and vice versa. So every department were very good in their area, and every department basically got on with their area and created the world of. I had a nice bit of input, because sometimes you get it on a script, you get a little remark on a script, and you go, I know where the guys want to go with this. So you have a little bit of an input, you know, of areas, and, you know, if it feels like it's a Japanese feel, or, you know, it depends on where the guys want to push it. You might read something in the script and go, oh, I see the underlying what they're talking about. And the great thing about it, everybody was approachable. It was a great family feel, and it was tough. I mean, it was tough. You know, it's quite simple. You didn't have, you know, the faint-hearted didn't survive, and the people that, you know, just got on with it, got it done, and it was, you know, it was great to do. Obviously, with the visual effects, they'd want the dagger a certain length, so you end up, you know, you cut something, it's never the right size, so we'll always leave it full length, and you then basically go to the visual effects, where do you want to cut, and you go there, and you go. A lot of these are used for plant-ons, because special effects need a little bit of blade, so they can either clamp it so it sits on. So we'll use it as a clamp-on that's either fixed into a plate and clamped on, and then it's just there featured-wise. So that's the way they normally do. We do lightweights. I mean, again, a lot of this is only resin, but this, you know, we've also got. You got biscuit foam that keeps everything light, so it's, again, you know, it'll break in seconds type of thing, but it's, again, it's very light, just for especially for prosthetics. If you need a facial or an arm area, it needs to be as light as possible, so we'll do a lot in biscuit foam then from that point onwards. But we'll normally do these in a rubber, even in a hard rubber, and then cut accordingly, or the odd time in the resin or the biscuit foam. I'm not involved on with the House of the Dragon weapon wise. So I was happy to see something that was created for Game of Thrones and by myself and the team on the show. And it was great, you know. And also, it does tell you history, because at the end of the day, we never knew, and I still didn't know where this history was from, this prior to it coming into the Assassins, or the Assassins' hands at the time. And then we obviously get the world of Littlefinger, you know, owning up to it. And then it gets on to Arya, and Arya has it then for the, you know, the killing of the White Walkers. But you look at this going, where did it originate? Really, where did it originate? So it's good to see that it was in the Targaryen world, and, you know, features again. And it matches, it joins the two shows up to a certain degree, in a small way. But for me, it joins it up in a weapons way, which is great. I'm very proud of all the equipment and all the weaponry that we've made, because we've made thousands. Like, you can see by what's around us, this is nothing. This is a drop. It's a drop in the ocean of what's in here, that what is and what we did physically make. So I was very proud to see it. I was happy that they did use it, and hopefully it'll play a nice part in the House of Dragon, you know.